We'll go ahead and get started. All right, welcome everyone. Thank you for continuing to stay with us for this session. So as you can see, we're talking about new ideas in assessment and feedback. New ideas, old ideas, is such an issue always that I'm really looking forward to hearing what our presenters have to say. Somewhat differently, I think we have an all UK panel of speakers, which has not been the case, I think, in the other session. So excellent stuff. Just a few housekeeping things. As you can see already, the session is being recorded and it will be uploaded to YouTube. You can, if it's useful to you, enable the live transcription as well. During the presentations, you have two buttons next to each other, the Q&A button and the chat button. If you can please put any questions for the presenters into the Q&A. What we'll do is after each of the presentations, I'll select a couple of sort of pressing questions or clarifying questions to ask straight afterwards, and then we'll move on to the next presentation just to make sure that we have you know, comfortably enough time for all of the presentations, but we'll come back at the end to sort of wrap up any of the other questions that we can. In the Q&A function, if there's a question that you really like, you want to be asked live and so on, press the like button so it's upvoted, and that's what I'll use to sort of select the questions if there are lots of them. And we have found in previous sessions that people are quite active, which is great, thank you. And then if there are any questions that we don't get to answer live on here, so the CTEL team will have these questions answered, and they'll be available on our website as well after the conference. All right, so that's enough from me. I'm going to stop my share and hand over to Petar to take us off.
Thanks, Parama, and thanks everyone for coming. Let me share my screen. All right, so here's the plan. I'll briefly motivate why we're dealing with the problem of authenticity, and then I'll go over the ways we understand authenticity. I'll also give you a bit more information about data I have collected and the methodology to address the main question of this work, which is, are exams authentic assessment? And I'll show you the results and give you some further thoughts at the end. Now, why are we dealing with exams authenticity? Now, there's two reasons. And the first one is that it has been shown that exams perpetuate attainment gaps. Now, attainment gaps will then go on to cement social inequalities. And you will understand that if, especially UK audience and the US audience will understand that if a government is interested in reducing social and racial inequalities, right, especially in attainment, it will push for a lower share of final exams. And that's the first part of the motivation. Exams have been here for centuries, but they're gradually giving way to novel assessment methods. But the second motivational factor is that the pandemic has accelerated this assessment reform, didn't it? So we have permanently lower shares now of final exams and higher share of continuous assessment. And many students and stakeholders in the process are advocating bolder assessment reforms, including eliminating final exams. And I have eliminated final exams from one of my own courses, but I'm not ready to eliminate them from all my exams unless we have a convincing debate on the following question: do exams lack real authenticity? And before I give you the answer to this question, let me define authenticity in the first place. So what's authenticity of final exams? Now, Grant Wiggins was the pioneer of the concept in 1989, imagined authenticity as a true test of a student's intellectual ability. And this true test was supposed to do two things, right? So match the challenges that students face in the professional world on one hand, and then make students perform to the best of their intellectual abilities. So in the beginning, authentic was a mix of backward and forward reflection, if you want. So what have I learned and what am I going to do with this? But gradually, higher education expanded, didn't it? Expanded into niches that are all they want is job market prospects. And then assessment of authenticity is today understood in a somewhat reductionist fashion. So as a work-related assessment, as one capable of replicating the task and performance standards of work, and not least preparing the students for meeting employer needs. That's these are the latest definitions of authentic assessment. And in this talk, in this paper, I'll take this narrower view, not because I'm a particular fan of higher education turning into a factory for job market ready candidates, but I will adopt this narrower view because I have a goal on my hand, right? I need to measure authenticity somehow, as imperfect as that measure as it may be. So then my main question in this work is, it becomes as follows: to what extent we have an overlap of final exams with workplace assignments? And we can, of course, use as many dimensions as we want to measure that overlap, but I'm keen on testing authenticity along the following two: time and type. And the reason I choose these two dimensions is that it's easy to calibrate along these two dimensions, both final exams and job market tasks soon after graduation. So I have this, essentially, I have this 3x3 map, and I box final exams and job assignments into each of these map cells and then see the overlap between them. So most of you will be aware of the distinction, of course, between routine applied and creative assignments and tasks, but let me explain them for the purposes of this work. I have asked my respondents the following question: are you an academic, an employer, or a recent graduate? And if you are an academic, you're asked to choose the typical question of your final exam. And by typical question, I mean the question that students see most often. If it's about understanding the facts and theories to which students have been exposed many times during the term, it will be classified as routine. If it's about the application of those theories, it will be classified as an applied, typical applied question. And finally, if it uses more higher order skills, it will be classified as creative. And naturally, we can find the same distinction that can be applied to the job market tasks of fresh graduates, and especially in their first year on the job. The typical assignment a fresh graduate sees on the job can be routine, applied, or creative. So to have a clearer picture of where these assignments and final exams stand in my 3x3 map, I asked my respondents not only about a typical question, but also a typical job market assignment, but also the share of routine, applied, and creative questions. And I also want to know how long does it take to complete them. So here's what I have as a first point of contact with the data. I have 144 replies to my questionnaire, and as we can see, there's two things that stand out immediately, right? That the first thing is that the type of typical questions and assignments overlap to a great extent. There's virtually no difference between routine, applied, and creative type of tasks on the job market and in final exams. But where students are a bit more pressed for time is the final exams, right? So you can argue that based on the timing of these assignments and exams, our assessment is not authentic, but in terms of type of assessments, it is fairly authentic. So I decided to dig a bit deeper and produce some heat maps of the overlap between exams and job market assignments. And the main innovation of this paper, though, is not the heat maps. Heat maps have been with us for some time. The main innovation is going to one step further from data visualization and actually producing quantitative measure of authenticity. And this is basically a layout of how I do it. So I run bivariate regressions of the share of routine, applied, and creative questions on a dummy variable equal to one if the respondent belongs to the job market. So if they're fresh graduates or employers. And that's how I find the differences between the shares of exams and assessment and assignments in each cell of my 3x3 map. And I call this difference the IJ, right? IJ corresponding to the map, the cell. And then I average those differences across the entire map. And I get an index varying between minus one and one. And naturally, the lower the differences between exams and job market assignments, the higher the overlap with professional workplace assignments. So an index closer to zero will then indicate more authentic assessment. So here are the heat maps. If you're using just data visualization methods, you may conclude that exams are not really authentic because of the time shift, right? Specifically, you have a time shift in which graduates receive more time to the applied assignments than they do on the job, right? So however, if you calculate the differences in the share of questions or assignments, you will not see much of a difference. And the simple average of those differences is fairly close to zero. And of course, you'll notice that some of these cells don't contain enough observations to run meaningful comparisons. That's normal with 144 observations in 9 cells. That doesn't give you a lot of degrees of freedom, right? So I bunched these timings together and studied the differences within each type of question, right? So I ran it for the share of routine questions with and without additional controls, and for routine applied with and without additional controls, and creative with and without additional controls, and still not much of an aggregate difference. So the aggregate authenticity index that I produce is still close to zero. So, which means authentic assessment, we're doing well. So let me conclude. The study looks at assessment authenticity along two dimensions only, right? Time and type. Of course, this is a reductionist perspective, right? There are other dimensions of authenticity, which I ignore, but this comes with an added benefit. Yeah, authenticity becomes quantifiable, and you could place it on a 3x3 map. And this map demonstrates that final exams that we do in economics are, to a large extent, authentic assessment, especially when it comes to the type of exams that we produce. But I also know that this result has been reached with just 144 observations, right? And I would be very grateful if you could contribute further to this study and add your perspective, where most of us are academics here, add your perspective on the type and time of exams that we give. It's just a couple of minutes, and I promise it's anonymous unless you want to share your contact information with me. So while you're filling out the survey, I'll close with my main contribution to this to the literature, and that's quantifying authenticity. We need this quantification because we want to have a better understanding of assessment authenticity. But also, we want to ensure that our students are on the right track when it comes to employability skills. But I think, above all, this study could make an impact in a way, in the sense that it could prevent policy misleveraging. That means policy scaling up to address a non-existing problem, right? So a problem that we think exists, but it doesn't, right? And we're throwing a bunch of solutions at a non-existing problem that's not going to solve the problem in the first place. So I'll be happy to address any questions and expand on the exciting issue of authenticity of final exams. Many thanks for having me, and I hope you stay in touch. Thanks.
Great, thanks a lot, Peter, and excellent timekeeping to kick things off. So exemplar for everyone else.
Thank you.
There's a couple of questions. So like I said at the start, for those of you who came in afterwards, I'm gonna ask sort of a few questions, which are sort of clarifying kind of things after each of the presentations, and save the rest for after all of the presentations. So the one that I will ask here, because I think it's quite important to understand what you're saying here, Exams, so Carlos Cortinas asks, exams mean different things to different people. So for example, for some it means quizzes, for others it means, you know, essay type questions, closed book, open book, you know, various things like that. So can you say a little bit more about how you defined exams versus other things?
Right, so as you say, the answer to some extent is in question, doesn't it? So it means various things to various people. So that's why I'm asking, what's the typical question in your exam? And then I'm asking the share of routine applied and creative questions. So basically, if you are asking a routine question, if the main question in your exam the type is routine, then most likely you will end up with a lot of quiz type questions allowing for not much creativity. And most of them are going to be, you know, multiple choice, very likely. But if the typical question in your exam is creative, then that would be an open book exam closer to, let's say, evaluating novel events and applying novel theories to, or perhaps questioning our own wisdom as economists, right? So indeed, I don't confine the definition of an exam to a single type of exam. I treat exams as assessment methods to test a variety of lower and higher order skills.
Great, thanks a lot. I have a feeling that we'll have other questions about this throughout, especially after the other presentations. I'll just ask you one more question here, Peter, if that's okay. So there's a question from Mark Leonard about how do you make sure that the applied creative, you know, the different categories that you have don't overlap? So again, a question about definitions, really.
Well, I want to make sure that they do actually overlap. What academics understand by an applied exam is the same thing as, you know, job market people understand by applied assignment, right? And that's why I give them as close as possible definition of an applied task and as close as possible definition of an applied question on an exam as possible, right? So I want to have exactly to prevent this diverging understanding of what applied is, a diverging understanding of what creative is, I give them a definition of these concepts that is as close as possible to each other.
Great. There's one more question that I'll ask here, and I'm keeping an eye on the time here. So Sarah Jacobson asks, I'd be curious if you're interested in looking at another distinction, which often differentiates exams versus more real life assessments, whether reference materials can be sought out and used. So kind of open bookish, but more than that. So it's not just looking up answers in a book, but actually referencing other materials, that kind of thing.
Sorry, can you repeat the question? Sorry, Parama, I think I lost you midway through.
No,
sorry.
That's all right. So the question is if whether you've looked at another kind of distinction, which often differentiates exams from more sort of real life or authentic, you know, whatever you want to call it, other type of assessments. And the distinction is, the dimension is whether reference materials can be sought and used. So there's an element of open book versus closed book here, but perhaps you can answer it more broadly in terms of, you know, seeking out materials yourself rather than things that are given to you by the lecturer.
Right. So again, unfortunately, I have adopted this reductionist view of authenticity, which doesn't really allow me to spread out the dimensionality of the concept further than just two dimensions, time and type. If you, if you try further proliferating the dimensions of the study, then you need a lot of data to be able to match the authenticity. You have 3 by 3 by 2 dimensions, that becomes 18 cells, you know, and that has to be generated with observations on both the academic side and the practitioner's side, which very quickly increases the demand for data. Most of the studies that we're reading on authenticity are published with 150 to 200, 300 observations. You can't do really much with, you can't really collect much more data than this. Of course, I would love to have 9, 10 dimensions of authenticity, but then we have to run a worldwide study on authenticity to be able to feed the data requirements here. But yeah, I haven't, to make things short, I haven't looked at this distinction that the
I was going to say that's a great reason to have your QR code and ask other people, at least on the academic side, if we can get more data. And I think we said yesterday that there were people from every continent except for Antarctica here. So there's a, I don't know how you're going to get at the employment side, but the academic side, at least, perhaps this is.
Well, how I can tell you how I got it. I got it through LinkedIn. I basically connected with people on LinkedIn, graduates of Royal Holloway, and asked them, could they fill that survey for me? And the turnout was great. So I think if you're running these kind of studies, you could connect to your own alumni. The more the better, the merrier. Yep.
Excellent. Thanks a lot, Peter.
Thank you.
We're handing over for the next presentation, for the second presentation, to Lovleen and David.
Okay. Okay, we're both presenting on this, so both introduce ourselves at the beginning. My name is David Nicol, and I lead a Teaching Excellence Initiative project in the Adam Smith Business School at the University of Glasgow. Essentially, this means I work collaboratively with staff across all three programmes, including economics, on educational improvement projects. And a key theme in this work, which we're going to discuss today, is improvement in feedback practices.
Hi, my name is Lovleen Kushwah, and I'm lecturer in economics at Adam Smith Business School. I'm working alongside David on Teaching Excellence Initiative at the Business School, and more specifically, we worked on this project to improve feedback on thesis writing. Our plan for today is that David will give a brief account of theoretical thinking behind this project, and then I will take you through how we implemented it in case of economics dissertation.
I'm just setting my timer to make sure I don't go over time. Okay. I'd like to say at the outset that the research that we've been doing on feedback in the Adam Smith Business School is unlike most other research on feedback nationally and internationally. It starts from some different premises, for example, that feedback is a natural and ongoing process that permeates all learning, and it thus explores some different practices. So let me explain this in somewhat. When we talk about feedback, and if you look at the research literature, we normally think of feedback as the comments that lecturers or others provide on students' work, and that they use to make improvements. Feedback is always described as a kind of communicative exchange. It might be a dialogue, it might be comments. However, from a cognitive perspective, all feedback is internally generated by the student. Whenever a student receives comments from a teacher, these have to be turned into some kind of inner feedback if they have to have any effect. And it's this focus on inner feedback and the mechanism by which this inner feedback is generated that is the focus of this research in the Adam Smith Business School. Now, since the idea of inner feedback is not commonplace, I'd like to start with a definition. Lovely, okay. So in my definition, and papers I've written on this, I've said inner feedback is the new knowledge that students generate when they compare their current knowledge against some reference information guided by their goals. When I say guided by their goals, because students are always the protagonists of feedback. This diagram here shows how this plays out in comments. Students do some work, then we give them some comments, and they must compare those comments against the work they've done, and they generate feedback out of that. If they don't understand the comments and the feedback they generate is not necessarily very good, if they don't read the comments, then there is no feedback. And it's this inner feedback that leads to performance improvements. However, moving to the next slide, this next slide shows that in reality, students are generating feedback all the time. They're making comparisons and generating feedback all the time, even when there are no comments or dialogue with others. Looking at the right-hand side of this, feedback generation is a natural ongoing process that permeates all learning. For example, imagine a student producing a homework assignment. As the student is producing that work, an essay or a report, she is comparing what she's produced against different kinds of information. For example, information in a textbook to clarify understanding. She's going talking to some peers, comparing what the peers say against her work, or looking actually at the work of peers, or looking at some guidance documents, or looking at some journal articles, or going online and looking at a diagram or a table of data. In this scenario, students are using information all the time. In this scenario, we all are, we're all doing this. This is basically how we generate feedback. We're doing something, we compare it against something else, and we generate feedback out of that process. If we weren't generating feedback in this way, our behavior would be random and unpredictable. Now, the main points to look at in this diagram are that the only feedback that we plan for, usually, is teacher comments. We actually don't acknowledge that students are generating feedback all the time, so we don't actually build on student agency. Second, teacher comments only usually represent a small proportion of the information that students use to generate feedback. And they often come at the end, whereas these other things are occurring during the progress of a task. Another notable point about this is that students are not just comparing what they've done against similar items, exemplars. I'm saying they're comparing what they've done against information in a video or information in a lecture. So they're even using dissimilar item comparisons from this. So based on this idea, what we've been doing in the business school is having students deliberately make comparisons against their work, against information other than comments. Why should comments be the only comparator? Why should they be the best comparator? And what we found is that students can generate significant feedback on their own, and that this feedback not only augments teacher comments, but under the right circumstances, it can actually replace comments. So how exactly do we do this? Well, the key principle of this is to get students to do some work, to make a comparison, and to make the output of that comparison explicit in writing or in some graphical form or in discussion with peers or by updating their work. This is the key principle to building on these natural feedback processes. And note that this is quite different from saying to students, go and look at that item, that article. We're actually specifically telling students to make a comparison with an external resource and produce an output from that. The last slide, since I'm running out of time, I won't say much more about it. To me, this slide actually captures really the fundamental situation with regards to feedback in higher education. What we're not making use of is that broken leg of the stool. And once we put that leg into play, then we build a more solid platform for students' learning to develop their own agency and also to reduce teacher workload by sequencing comparisons, by using resource comparisons before peer work comparisons and end loading teacher comments. I'll pass you now back to Lovleen to present the example.
So let me illustrate how it worked for dissertation in economics. Once students submitted their dissertation proposal, they wrote their literature review, and we used this point to launch a pilot. We provided them with two well-written published literature reviews in economics, which they compare against each other. And these literature reviews were different from each other and from their own, the one they have written earlier. And we suggested to students to lay these two reviews side by side and then compare them. To make self-feedback explicit, they wrote down what they think made these reviews of high quality and what was common in both. So our aim with this comparison and asking that to be explicit was that students are generating an internal benchmark about a good literature review. And in next comparison, students compared the literature review with the self-generated feedback of the first comparison. And then they explicitly wrote again about how they compared their own literature review with the other two example reviews, and identifying and explaining differences in reference to each example one by one, and exploring what they would do to improve their literature review based on the instruction given so far. And finally, they identified further feedback that they needed from the supervisor. So we collected three sets of data. First one is a written account on inner feedback generation, and second one on students' perception using survey and focus group. And lastly, a comparison of students' self-generated feedback with that of the supervisor. So here are some students' comments. We find that generating inner feedback through resource comparison helps students identify key principles of a good literature review and critique their own work and find ways of improving their own work. There is self-regulation at play as well, since students draw learnings from the first comparison and use it to position their own comments and they comment on what have they done well and what needs to be improved. This is students' perception data, the findings from there. And here we find that students had a very positive experience of using comparison process to generate inner feedback. One of them even commented on the comparison process, as you can see, that using it earlier on in their university life, this practice can be ingrained. So it's very helpful. It can be ingrained a bit earlier on. Making inner feedback explicit was like really critical thing about this whole process, the resource comparison that we asked them to do. And students also recognized that this was particularly beneficial as they need not wait for the supervisor to return feedback to make any further progress in their work. So overall, there was a perceived reduction in dependency and students felt empowered. Coming to the final findings of the third data set, when we look at what feedback students produced, and what feedback the supervisor gave to them, we found that supervisor provided feedback on writing and content, and students were able to self-generate feedback on writing, but not on content. Supervisor feedback significantly overlapped with that of the students, which shows that how inner feedback can reduce the workload by allowing supervisors to focus only on those parts where students need expert advice. This does not mean that supervisor feedback is not required. On the contrary, students thought that supervisor feedback was useful in validating their self-feedback and identifying any blind spots. Further, students were able to request targeted feedback from the supervisor. And since comparators can shape inner feedback, supervisors can choose comparators which will address both writing and content feedback. So there is a lot more to this process. And here we have some other papers using resource comparison for generating inner feedback. And we also have a practical guide, the link for which is given on this slide, which has a lot of information and other examples for you to refer to. So I appreciate listening to us and thank you very much.
That was great. Thank you, Lovleen and David. And can I just say that's a really great initiative. I mean, we talk a lot about assessment and here in England, National Student Survey is coming up next week and assessment and feedback is where economics kind of, yeah, falls off the cliff edge. So this is really, really great. I have a couple of questions which I'm gonna ask here. So the first question is from Clodagh Jenkins. She asks, last week we had some discussion, this was on Twitter, about taking ideas from high school, secondary school, and in school. So those of us who have kids at the secondary level here in the UK right now, we'll know that they always ask students to reflect on the feedback. So they get written comments and then they have to respond to that, actually respond to it. Do you think we should be doing more of this? Are there other sort of feedback practices that we can learn from schools who've been doing this for a while?
Yeah, but what the schools have been doing in that example is that they're making comparisons against comments and making them explicit. And actually, it follows the same principle I'm talking about. But my question is, why should comments always be the only or the best comparators? And it turns out they're not. Each different kind of information results in students generating different kinds of feedback. And in actual fact, you know, comparing your work against exemplars, everyone knows, has a powerful effect. But actually, having students do compare against anything that has the educational value and deliberately reflect on it, as you say, make the comparison, make the result explicit, turns out to be very beneficial. Let me give you an example in economics. You know, let's say you get students to write a case study in some area, and then you give them a theory, a theoretical model or a diagram of a theory, and you say, compare this theory against that application you've just produced and tell me how you could improve the application. You're getting, using feedback to improve the theory practice understanding, the theory practice relationship. Alternatively, you could say, use the practice you've just done and see if you can critique the theory. Or you could give them a different theory and ask them to, from the one they used to create the application. So what we've been doing in the business school is using this comparison thing to develop critical thinking. And it takes feedback to a different level, because feedback's not just about getting the right answer. It's about developing different kinds of skills.
Yeah, that's a great point. And I think, so one way to maybe think about this is, if we're thinking, at least our UK students are coming into university having experience of comparing with one kind of comparator, and then The next step in university is opening that up. Okay, you know how to do it with one comparator. Here are these other comparators. But yeah, I mean,
thing for the teacher, and we didn't really have time to go into it, it's in the guide, is the instructions for the comparison, because the teacher still plays an important role, A, in selecting the comparators, and B, in giving the instructions to focus the students on something that's actually of importance, and the teacher will know what to focus the students on. The beauty of this method, though, is that it's happening anyway. Students are making these comparisons, whether we like it or not. All we're doing is bringing into play a natural process and making it a powerful pedagogical process.
Absolutely. So kind of related to that, and you answered a bit of that towards the end. The question here from Joel Clovis about how can supervisors know sort of the overlaps before they make the feedback? So, you know, are the overlaps sort of fixed in time, or how do you find the overlaps sort of fixed in time or across subjects? So that's one question. The other question I was going to ask, and you can answer these, by the way, I should have said this to all of the speakers, you can answer them on the Q&A yourself if you want to write. The other question I'm going to quickly ask here is, workload-wise for the students, do you have the feeling that they might think this is an assignment on top of another assignment? So they're doing the assignment and then they're, you know, it's more work. Maybe this is just our students, but yeah.
No, let me pass that one to Lovleen, so I'm not doing all the talking. Lovleen?
Yeah, so I would say that this is something we did it for final year students. You know, they are the ones writing the dissertation. And like I said, the initial reaction of students were like, why we didn't do it in the first year, because we would have learned this method in the first year and then used it all throughout our university years, like even if there is no prompt. So for example, one of my students did this literature review thing, and during our group discussion even mentioned that I'm already applying this method to the other parts of the dissertation. So even if it's, the idea is like once students, it's ingrained in them, they can do it anyways, and we don't have to probably do it for every single assignment, this process. What we'll have to do is, as you know, teachers, is that to guide them, and what David was saying, that these instructions will be crucial, which students will be generating, you know, that feedback on their own once they know in which direction to move, basically.
That's really great. So there's a question here also about, you know, can you do it with first years, for example, who are on the one hand perhaps easier to mold because, you know, they haven't gotten used to a way of feedback?
Basically, we've done it with first years, and we've basically shown that if you give students multiple comparisons one after the other, and you get this teacher independently to write what she would have written as comments, the students' comments will overtake what the teacher would have given them, for even for the worst students, because the more comparisons they make, the more feedback they generate, and they build on the feedback they've generated before. So we have a study there, one of those studies with Suzanne McCallum in accountancy, shows that students can generate you know, they can get almost all the points the teacher says, but they'll generate other things that the teacher has no time to tell them or is not able to tell them. So it's a really powerful technique. And really the thing about it is it's so simple. I mean, it's just so simple. We are, whenever you're writing a paper as an academic, you're comparing against other things. And all we're doing is making this a deliberate process. And basically in this way, you can make feedback run across the whole course without any workload increase to you, as long as, you know, after you've, you know, decided on the comparators, there's probably a workload to change. But once you've changed, because what takes time is writing comments, what you do is you end load teacher comments, you let them generate feedback through other means. And then when you see what they've generated, you actually find, as Lovleen found, that you actually don't need to give those comments. The thing about the study with Lovleen was that we, you know, Lovleen wrote the comments without seeing what the students wrote. Had she seen what the students had wrote, she would have needed to write much less.
That is really cool. So thanks a lot for that. I think you'll see in the chat that you're getting lots of positive comments about this initiative as well. There are a few other questions, but we'll come back to them. And like I said, you know, if you feel like you want to answer them, just by typing, you can do that as well. So I'm going to hand over to our final presenter, Vivien.
Hello, thank you, Parama. And thank you everyone for what's turning into a really, really interesting conference. I'll just share my slides. Perfect. Okay, so I'm Vivien, I'm based at the University of Reading. And in this presentation, I'd like to talk a little bit about a new assessment I introduced this past year in one of the third year modules that I teach. And the assessment was designed to give students the opportunity to tailor it to their own interests and experiences. Okay. So as we know, assessments fulfill a range of objectives. They obviously provide an important tool for us to understand how students are doing and how their learning is progressing. They also provide important feedback for us to know how we're doing as lecturers and instructors. They can provide very useful information on where or how best to target any additional support that's needed, but they should also provide a means for supporting and encouraging student learning. Now, obviously, things like the number of assessments you have in a module and the timing of these assessments play an important role in achieving these different objectives. But what I was interested in learning a bit more about was whether or to what extent the nature of an assessment task itself could have an impact on students' motivation for learning and their approach to learning. And in particular, I was interested to see whether having an assessment that students could tailor in some way to their own interests and experiences affected the way they learn. There's also secondary motivation here, which has to do, I think, with this ongoing challenge of designing effective open book take-home assessments. So thinking of questions that encourage students to really go beyond the material that we're giving them and think about applying that material. Now, because we are, I think, mainly an audience of economists, I feel it's important to qualify what I'm about to say and to make it very clear that I'm not aiming to establish any sort of causal relationship between this particular assessment and how students approach learning. So this is very much an exploratory study, and I would, of course, appreciate any comments or suggestions you have at the end of the presentation. So in terms of the context, so I introduced this assessment in an undergraduate third year optional module that I teach, which is urban economics, which this year had 53 students on it. And this module is typically taken by students on different programs, so with different interests and backgrounds. So I'll have some students who are doing a single honors BA or BSc in economics, but a lot of students are doing joint honors programs. So whether that's geography and economics, I have some students doing languages in economics or politics and international relations in economics, for example. The module is also very popular with students on our newest program, which is a program that we run joint with an institution in Nanjing in China, where students do the first 3 years of their program in China, and then they come to Reading to do the final year. Now, the way the module assessment works, it has two components. So there's one piece of coursework, which counts for 40% of the final mark, and one final exam in the summer term, which counts for the other 60%. And the coursework includes a combination of short answer questions and exercises and one longer essay type question, which has a word limit of 1,000 words. Now, in the past, students were only given one essay type question, which they had to answer. And this year, I gave them an option of two essay type questions to choose from. And I'll talk a little bit more about those in a second. The coursework is submitted just after halfway through the term. And I release the questions early on in the term, and students are encouraged to work on the assignment on a regular basis rather than leaving it all to the last minute. So in terms of the assessment itself, for the longer essay type questions, these were the two questions that students had to choose from. The first one was the question that, or slightly modified version of a question I've been using for the last few years. And the new question I introduced this year was question number 7. Alongside this, students were also given some general guidelines on the word limit, the marking criteria, and they were also encouraged to come to me if they had any questions or if they wanted to discuss a plan of their answers. Now, the first question is essentially asking students to use the theories covered in the module to assess the impact of the COVID pandemic on the evolution of cities. And with this question, although it's not made explicit, the link between the question and the relevant course material, I think, is much more obvious to students. With the second question, students were asked to pick any city, or an urban area of their choice, and to assess how useful the concepts and theories that we covered in the module are for explaining the development of their chosen city. Now, with this question, students had a range of concepts and theories that they could bring in. So in the module, we look at, for example, theories that explain why cities exist, that explain how they develop, theories that explain differences in the size and structure of cities. So there's a lot of information students could draw from, and they weren't expected to bring in absolutely everything, because that would just be impossible in 1,000 words. So I think, on the one hand, the second question gives students a lot more flexibility, but it is also more challenging because part of the exercise also involves identifying what theories and concepts they think are more useful or more relevant, and then working on applying those. I should also say, so the question says explicitly that they can pick any city apart from New York City. And the reason for doing this was because one of the core readings that I give in the first part of the module is this article by Ed Glaser, where he essentially does this exercise, applying different theories on of the development of cities to the development of New York City. So students had that as a resource, but they were encouraged to pick a different city to focus on. So how did students do? Now for this, in this last year, just over a quarter of students answered the second question. So the majority of students still went with the first question. I got a range of very interesting answers covering a range of cities, including Atlanta, Bangalore, Birmingham, Bristol, London, Manchester, Shenzhen. In most cases, students did focus on the city they'd grown up in, but not in all cases. So I had a couple of students who picked a city, not quite at random, but a city they'd never, I think in both cases, they'd never visited before, but they were just very interested in finding out more about that city. Now, in terms of sort of evaluating this exercise, it is complicated because the sample size I have is quite small, and there are most likely self-selection issues going on as well. But I did find, reading through the assignments, that overall, I felt students who worked on the second question, the quality of their answers was better. So there was a slight difference in the average marks. Again, I don't think sort of these two subsamples are directly comparable, But what I did find was reading through the students' work that there was a clear effort at not just describing particular concepts and theories, but actually thinking about how they applied to their chosen city. And in discussions I had with students both before and after submitting the assignment, I felt that doing this exercise had also got them to think about the material in a new way, and getting them to think about questions about this gap between the theories that we cover and reality, and how sometimes theories match reality quite closely, but other times they don't, and it's interesting to think about why they don't. Now, in terms of the feedback I got from students, unfortunately, I wasn't able to get any specific written comments about this assignment in the end of module evaluations. The overall feedback from students on the module was very positive, and a lot of student comments highlighted this scope to, or the way that the module brought in real world examples and encouraged them to bring in real world examples as well. So to think about how what they were covering in the module is actually relevant for understanding what's going on in the world. I had quite a lot of discussions with students both before and after they submitted the assignment, and several students commented on how they felt the assessment in particular had encouraged them to look at cities in a different light. So I had one student, for example, who came up to tell me that now whenever she went back home, she paid much more attention to variations in the height and the age of buildings in her city. And she was always thinking back to what we covered in the module and how that linked in with what she saw. And I had another student, for example, who got very interested in the history of production in his particular city and how that had changed over time and why it had changed. So I was quite encouraged by the fact that I think this assessment did either stimulate or at least nurture students' curiosity and creativity, which I think is a very positive thing. So what have I taken away from this exercise? Now, perhaps on a somewhat selfish note, it did make having this question in the assessment did make marking much more interesting, which I think for me, and I think for a lot of us, given the amount of marking we have to do, anything that makes marking more interesting is always a bonus. But I also think it challenged students to think more critically about the concepts and the theories that we were covering in the module. And to demonstrate a greater breadth of understanding, because for this question, the links between the particular topics weren't as clear. So students had to have a good overall understanding of the topics that it covered to be able to then select what would be most relevant. However, I did have some concerns that maybe I was offering them too much flexibility and that this might have discouraged some students from answering this question. So because it was quite open-ended, I think there was more uncertainty around what was required for a good answer. I'm thinking of sticking with this question or a version of this question in future, but I think I need to work more on either providing clearer guidelines or a clearer link between the marking criteria and the question, so students can approach it with a bit more confidence, knowing that they're on the right track. And I guess related to this point, having clear marking criteria was crucial, both for me and for the students. And for the students in particular, I think there's still a bit more work for me to do. Thank you very much for listening, and I look forward to any comments or questions or suggestions you might have. Thank you.
Great, thanks a lot, Vivien. So we have a couple of questions coming in through the chat to me, actually. So let me ask the first one, which is just a little bit more sort of information about sort of what kind of background these students are coming in, to sort of what they've done before they come in here, so how well prepared they are, something like that, how many, and then also what kind of scaffolding or support you do provide. So you said a little bit at the end about the flexibility of the open-endedness about the question, because one of the issues that I think that people face is, you know, more sort of authentic, innovative, whatever assessments are not things that people are used to. So for students, they need more support. With bigger groups, that becomes a challenge.
Yes, I absolutely agree. So in terms of the background, all of the students have the same background knowledge in micro and macroeconomics. So they do that up to intermediate level. Some students will be doing advanced micro and macroeconomics over more, I guess, theoretical models. The main difference is in the knowledge of or their quantitative skills. So students on the BA program and joint honours have less advanced maths and stats, basically, which isn't as relevant for this assignment. And on your second point, I absolutely agree. And I think this is an area that I haven't quite, I still need to do some more work on, because the challenge is, as you say, I think students, while I think they appreciate the opportunity to be able to focus on things that interest them, they also want to be confident that they're going into it knowing what a good answer will look like. And the way I tried to do it this year was by going through, so I had a separate session where I went through the marking criteria with them and I gave them a few examples to illustrate what each point on the marking criteria was. But I think given the number of students who didn't choose that question, I mean, it might just be a matter of interest, but I feel partly that it was also the worry that they wouldn't know what a good answer would look like, so it was better not to risk it.
I'm thinking about comparators all the time now, Lovleen and David's comparators every time. So yes. You've definitely changed, the way I'm thinking about things. Mm-hmm. So kind of related to that last bit that you said, a couple of questions here. So first of all, Joe Blendon asks, why did you decide not to require all students to take the second assessment? And then Joel Clovis asked, did you warn the students about the nature of the second question in an assignment brief, for example? So did they know something about what was coming in that question?
Yes. So with the first question, it was mainly, I was concerned that, I wasn't sure, because it was the first time I was doing it, I wasn't confident that the way I'd phrased the question and the way I'd given the guidelines and information to students would be enough. So my worry was that if I required all students to do it, and then a big proportion of students ended up submitting answers that were completely off the mark, I would feel, I guess I'm sort of always responsible as a lecturer for what students do to some extent, but because it was the first time I was doing it, I wanted to run it more or less as a pilot. And it also meant that I could give more support to students who were working on that particular question, or even on the other question, and who had doubts or who wanted to check whether they were on the right track. And I did give students information. So I ran a session with them talking through the marking criteria to really emphasize that what I was looking for was not a description of the history of an evolution, of the evolution of a particular city, but it was really about applying concepts and theories. Gave them some examples on how to do that. I also referred them back to this article by Ed Glazer that we looked at to give them an idea of how they could do that in practice. So I did that, but I feel like that's where I need to maybe improve things a bit more if I want to run this again next year.
So just on that, Joe Blandon asks, as is always our question for everything that is started as a pilot, are you tempted to be braver next time? And let me just add a query to that as well. Do you feel like, so for students, they often see things from a kind of program level. So a student's eye view is, I have these four modules, you know, however many you have, you know, what's kind of, are there similarities? Am I approaching assessment in the same way, that kind of thing? So do you feel like are other things like that happening in other parts? Like students are seeing this not in an isolated way in your module, but elsewhere as well. And thus, does that affect sort of what your plans are for the future?
That's a very good question. I think on the first point, I'm trying to get myself to be a bit more confident to run it next year and to get all students to, say, give all students the opportunity to answer that question. And I think I need to fine tune the guidelines. I give them a bit more to get that to work well. With the program level question, I think I find it really interesting because the two final year modules that I teach both attract a large number of joint honours students. And I find that there's a lot of variation among students in how well they do make the links between what they cover in different modules, and particularly if they're modules in different subjects. My impression overall is that most students still approach modules in a very compartmentalized way. And it is something that I'm keen to, I think, encourage students to break away from, but I don't really know what the best way to do that is. But I think it is, I think part of the problem is the way that we structure programs around modules, and then we keep encouraging students to relate things to what they cover in other modules. But of course, if we don't know what they're covering in other modules, it's harder to provide examples. And I think examples really help students to try and understand what we expect them to do. So
there's, I mean, go ahead, David.
I was going to say, I suppose that you could use, I mean, thinking of comparisons, you could give students some examples from the previous, from the cohort you've just worked with to the new students, and say to them, what makes these examples interesting examples? I mean, there must be something about them. If you picked a couple of good examples and they were different, there must be something in the deep structure of them that make them quite good in the way they've used the theories or something. And you could ask students to try and determine what that was before they did their own. And that might be a good starting point for that project, because you now have some examples of work that's different. You know, I mean, the topic might be, the city they choose might be different, or the topic could be different, but you've still got, because you know, examples don't need to be in the same context. In fact, often it's better if they're not, as in the Lovleen and our example, the students were looking at two literature reviews that were different from their own and different from each other, because a literature review at its deep structure has certain features that make it good. And I suppose in terms of your example of the of what the students were doing, the more open-ended one, there was something that makes that example good, and that's what needs to be brought out, perhaps.
Yes, I think that's an excellent suggestion. I think students do learn a lot by, and I think it helps reassure students when they can see an example of something done well, and or even something that's not done completely well, but that they can draw their own conclusions from, and giving them that confidence to then do it themselves as well. So
The interesting thing would be, in terms of the Lovleen study, is, you know, is comparing two that are done well, but they look different. There must be something similar about them, and asking them, what are the similar things that make these two examples good, even although they're quite different?
That's really good. I mean, you know, you're sort of teaching them how to use the comparators, basically. You know, you're not just reading these things and thinking, this is a good one, let me copy this. You're thinking, there's some principles, there's some characteristics. That's what. Related to that, there was a question for you guys, Lovleen and David, actually, from Carlos Cartinia. So let me ask that with a little bit added from myself. So the question was, but will students not copy the baseline examples? In the dissertation example, that's perhaps less of an issue because it's open-ended and so on. But in other sort of situations...
This is the most common question, though, but it reveals a kind of... it reveals that we're not really using exemplars to maximum effect. There are three types of exemplars one can use. An exemplar that's in the same content area, and doing the same thing. So the student writes an essay on a certain topic in economics and they compare it against other essays on the same topic. But a student could write an essay on a topic in economics and compare it against an essay on a completely different topic that's well written. Then they'll generate feedback on how to write good essays. But in my own subject, because I'm not an economist, let's say a student writes an essay on working memory, and I give them some essays on long-term memory, and I say, look at these essays on long-term memory. How could you improve your essay on short-term memory? Well, long-term and short-term memory are connected together. This intermediate stage, no one really uses. So you get the students, they're looking at content that's in the same area, but it's slightly different. And they're developing their understanding of the content, while at the same time, they're looking at essays on long-term memory that are written very well. So they're comparing against high quality essays as well. So they develop their understanding of how to write a good essay. So I think that we can be more inventive about using exemplars. They don't need to be in the same area, content area at all, in order to be of value. So they can't copy them. If students can copy the deep structure of an essay and write a good essay based on copying that, I don't think many teachers are going to have a problem with that.
Absolutely. So copying the model is perfectly fine, right? But copying the example, as long as you design something that where it doesn't make sense, or you know, it doesn't give them much to copy the example. Vivien, there was actually another one for you. So if I can come back to give you a little bit of a rest there, but come back to you. And then, by the way, people, there's we still have a little bit of time. So if you have further questions for any of the three presentations, please drop them into the Q&A or you know, vote up as well. So this is from Sarah Jacobson for Vivien. I love this exercise. On exams, I've taken away choice on questions because it makes it harder to give similar levels of partial credit across the different options. And students often seem to get stymied by the freedom offered to them and just answer way off the mark. So can you say more about how you avoid these problems? So you did say a little bit, I think. So if you just want to add anything on that.
Yes, that's a really good question. And I have to say, I'm not completely confident that I have managed to avoid it altogether. The reason why I like to offer students choice is because I feel students have different interests. And within a module, if you're covering lots of different topics, some topics will appeal to students more than others. And I find I prefer to give students the option of focusing on the topics they're interested in. But it does create a problem when marking. And I think with this particular assessment, I was very conscious, and particularly because I felt the second question was more challenging to the extent that it required students. They couldn't just go to a particular topic and pull out, oh, these are the theories I'm supposed to discuss. Part of the exercise was actually identifying what they felt were the relevant theories and concepts. I think I was very mindful when I was marking to make sure that I wasn't penalizing those students for focusing on particular theories and concepts rather than other ones. So I think it's a really good question. Unfortunately, I don't feel I've got a definite answer to it. I think it is just something where, I guess also looking at the distribution of marks at the end and getting a sense of, you know, did students who answered a particular question do a lot better than other students? And of course, that might just be because they were better prepared. But often, or I will always, if there is a big difference in the marks distributions, I'll always have a closer look to make sure that the criteria I was using for marking were comparable. But yes, I think that's
a bit
of
an
imperfect answer, but it's definitely one to think about.
It's just a tough one. Yeah, absolutely. There's a question here for Peter, for you, from Nicola Birkin. She asks, in the workplace, people can and do consult with other people to do their work, but this is an issue in individual exams or coursework, you know, sort of controlled sort of environment kind of assessment. So in general, speaking about sort of thinking about authentic assessment and so on, given that at least here in the UK, we're in a highly regulated system, there's all kinds of rules about, you know, these kinds of things and group work and this and that and what you need to do to make sure that, you know, various things haven't happened and stuff like that. Any thoughts?
I would love to imagine a world in which authentic assessment features, you know, collaborative exam taking, you know, but that I can't really see that happening anytime soon in the UK, at least. Now, this is moving to seriously answering the actual question. You know, this is one of those dimensions where it's hard to measure authenticity in this particular study that I'm doing. You know, because we don't really see. We don't really see collaborative exams. If you ask students, say, to write a collaborative paper and then evaluate them based on that paper, that could indicate some teamwork going forward, that could mimic teamwork in the workplace. But then that paper writing has to be accompanied by, let's say, a protocol attached to the paper about who did what in that group work. I've had assessments like that, and you know, it didn't work really well with delivering the protocol. Typically, you're facing a typical free rider problem where you know, one of the students would would just write the paper for the rest of the students. But hey, isn't that exactly what authentic is? I mean, in the workplace, you also tend to see people that are doing all the work, and the rest are some of the rest of the people are free writing on it. And that's also authentic in a sense, isn't it?
That's true. Dealing with the free writers, dealing with the fights that happen in between, sort of within groups and things like that. Yeah, all life skills, I guess. So hopefully the OFS is okay with that, sort of testing those things as well. Thank you. David and Lovleen, I have another one for you from Doug McKee. So he says, I think there are some cases where exemplars can reduce creativity. For example, I have my students create posters for their projects, and when I give exemplars, most copy the structure of the one they like and just fill it in. Any thoughts, any top tips for avoiding, if you think this should be avoided?
Yeah, I think we need, I was trying to answer that question in the chat. I think we need to distinguish between near and far examples. I mean, the further the example, you know, what I can't say about this is I once ran a session actually with academics, and the role was that they had to design an implementation of something that would help develop students' self-regulatory ability. And it was a very open-ended task, and they all, and I didn't realize that some of them would give a very long example, some gave an example in a single class. Anyway, I had to just mix them up and give them to each other, to other people. So I just picked them randomly and circulated them all. And what I found was that comparing apples and bananas proved to be very enlightening for everyone. When they were comparing something that was so different from what they produced, they actually generated more interesting stuff than they did when they got something that was similar. So I think the other thing is that about this that I haven't really covered in any depth in this is that I'm not just talking about exemplars in my work. I'm talking about non-exemplars. Comparing, a student writes a report, an analysis of some aspect in economics, and you say, go and listen to those videos of those experts talking about that particular subject and tell me how you can improve your report. Now, they can't copy, you know, they can copy, they need to integrate what that person has said into their own report in some way and improve it. So exemplar, it doesn't really need to be exemplars. There's a lot to be said for non-exemplars. I mean, for example, in some subjects, and probably in economics as well, in order to understand certain quantitative things, you need to be able to understand graphs. You need to be able to understand tables of data. You need to be able to understand flowcharts. So you get students to produce something and they compare it against a graph or a flowchart or a table of data, and they start to learn how to integrate how these things relate to each other, and they generate feedback about multiple different types of representation. In areas like chemistry, you can't understand chemistry by written text alone. It's impossible to understand chemical reactions without seeing photographs and seeing other things. And it's probably similar in economics, that we need to be looking more widely. Students do something, they compare against a diagram. They do something, they compare against a table of data. They do something and they compare against stuff. They talk about a process and they compare against a flowchart. And this is what we've been doing in the business school. You know, in, for example, in bad debt, in accountancy, the teacher teaches some problem about bad debts, about how to compute those, and then gives a discussion of how she thinks about that problem as she's solving it herself. And then the students compare their thinking with the teacher's thinking and write down what they learned from that. So there's a lot more to this that we don't really have time, but the guide will be very helpful. If the link to the guide can be made available, which was on the slides.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think there were a couple of questions about that.
The examples in the guide go from mathematical to textual, from simple, doing it in a lecture class, to doing it in a bigger kind of topic, a longer topic. So I've tried, and then from different disciplines, from economics, accountancy and finance, and management. And management is one where we have been using this idea of near and far comparisons. Nick Quinn in management has been using this to develop students' ability to think out of the box.
Good stuff. Because you brought up the topic of the workshop with faculty, and there's a question here from Clodagh Jenkins. It's actually from the whole panel, but I'll start with you guys, Lovleen and David. So in the UK, definitely on very large modules that we often have in economics, there are PhD students working as teaching assistants who are the ones actually giving feedback or sort of connecting directly with the students in terms of giving them comments or whatever it is. How can we help them sort of take this kind of approach, different sort of kind of approaches to feedback? So, you know, your approach, but then more generally, different kind of approaches to assessment and feedback, given that many of them, I mean, we have probably done this ourselves, right? We do things in the way that we were taught, and that's going to be different, and it's not like any of these things that we're talking about today. And then B, they often see their teaching tasks as a minor part of what they do, or you know, they are pressed for time, and you know, there's cognitive overload of all the things they have to do. So, you know, getting to a certain extent, maybe getting actual faculty on board might be a little bit easier because that's part of what they're paid for, though some of them don't think that. But for PhD students, for teaching assistants, do you have any advice for people who have maybe 6, 7, 8 teaching assistants? So there is the issue of, you know, teaching them how to do this and sort of incentivizing them to do this. But then also, if you have multiple teaching assistants, you want a similar approach. So you want kind of uniformity.
Yeah. I don't know what Lovleen, does Lovleen want to say something here?
Yeah, I just wanted to say, like, the first thing comes to my mind is teach them this method because they can use it for their PhD as well, you know, and of course, but I do think, and we know that when there are GTAs in our courses, we don't take a back seat. We are always also involved. So the thing is, what we found in our work was that there's a lot of information that is that students generate, or the feedback they generate, like coming from the writing, the way you write the stuff, and then there is the feedback on content. So what I felt was that we as experts, and even the PhD students as experts, can provide information more on content side, can make it more focused. So, and if they are involved with this idea of, like, you know, introducing the whole comparison process, they can also, like, somehow reduce their own work in that way. So really, you know, it's not that, you know, we are saying GTAs won't do anything at all. So, you know, they will come in together with us in that way. So there'll be creativity around there. And one thing that I didn't mention, neither me and David, was because we are introducing this, there is this whole power dynamic between the teacher and the student is diluted right now. So, you know, when, and especially with GTAs, we have seen that students tend to be closer to GTAs than as compared to the lecturers in terms of approach. So I think that will be narrowed down both for the GTAs as well as for us if we are using this, because we are basically enabling students to generate this feedback for themselves as well.
That's a lovely.
Yeah. Well, I used to actually train all the GTAs at the University of Strathclyde, so I know the GTA problem. But the real GTA problem is the GTAs often, because they've just understood the stuff themselves, they want to keep telling the students things.
Yeah.
They want to be telling, and the whole premise behind this feedback method is that feedback is telling. Is not the best method. It's one method out of three. So my stool is saying, what we do is we get the students to compare their work against something and generate some feedback. And then they get into groups and they discuss the feedback they've generated and the work they've produced. And then they write down some answers for the teacher, some questions for the teacher. And the teacher only provides the feedback that they can't self-generate. Now, it would be easy to prepare GTAs for this. You just give them a plan for the tutorial. You say, get the students to do something, then give them this as a comparison, then put them in groups, and then get them to ask you questions at the end. And that way, the GTAs will be take more of a back seat, and the students will do more of the learning. And that should work generally for all GTAs.
That's really great. There's lots of trainers of PGTAs here present, I think. So lots of good advice there. We have less than 5 minutes left. So Peter and then Vivien, if I can just ask you to come in for maybe 1 minute each, that would be great.
Thanks. So I just had an answer for the issue of multiple TAs and identical feedback needs. So the way I solve the issue is have them meet in a room together or online, and just have a conversation about how to ensure consistency across the variety of TAs, right? And that's a simple solution. I mean, you discuss what the requirements to the assignments are, and you ensure to the best of your abilities that those are applied. And that's at least what I do with my TAs. And if they have to mark a weekly assignment, then you meet with them on a weekly basis, weekly meetings. There's no other way to ensure consistency across assignments on a consistent basis, consistent marking. Anyway, sorry.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with you 100%. That has workload issues and all kinds of contractual issues and things like that, but that's just what you have to do. Vivien, just a minute on an answer to this.
Yes, so I don't think I have much more to add. I mean, I think any of these approaches involve more time, whether that's on the part of the lecturers, people supporting GTAs and PhD students. But I absolutely agree with Lovleen's point that the GTAs or PhD students will benefit from this as well. So I think it's worth the time investment.
Sorry, managed to not be able to unmute myself somehow. I put end there when I was doing so well. That's fantastic. Thank you very much, everyone, for all your contributions. I can see there's tons of things in the chat also. Sorry, didn't manage to get to that. What we will do, as we're doing at the end of each session, is collect any unanswered questions, comments, anything that came up, share them with the presenters who can then comment on them and then make these available along with the recordings on the CTEL website. So this is an ongoing conversation. These are big issues that all of us face. But can we just have a round of applause for our presenters on a very important and interesting, intriguing topic. We have about 5 or 6 minutes, just if you want a comfort break before our network mixer session after this. It's sponsored by the Royal Economic Society, and we're going to be talking about, hopefully getting lots of tips on, teaching track career. So do come and join us. You all have the links. There's the link as well from the CTEL team. And we will see you in a few. Take care.